While they're returning to their seats, I add my name to the list of those who like that song about as any song you've ever heard, and I've never heard it sound better. And I love you. Thanks for coming. Susan and I have been married for 4 years. We waited to get married until we had paid off our student loans. My wife had passed away, and her husband had passed away. And I said to my daughter, after a period of time, I would like to maybe date. I'm not good at being alone. And she said, who is your date? And I said, well, maybe Susan Easton Black, except she's out of my league. My daughter said, Father, nobody's out of your league. And that gave me courage, and I called her on the phone and made arrangements to go see her. And before going, because I was scared to death, I went over to the park where I go to pray and stood on a rock out in the stream and asked Heavenly Father. I told him I'd like to have something develop between Susan and myself, but I'm not good enough for her. And Heavenly Father spoke to me in my mind and said, if you're not good enough for her, why don't you step up? And I decided to try to do that, so I put on my navy blue suit and I drove to Provo. I prayed all the way there, and I stood on her porch and knocked, and I could hear her footsteps coming toward the door. I said to myself, I'm a priesthood man. Stood up straight, you know, like a priesthood man stands, not only physically but spiritually, stands up, looks people in the eye, lets them know that he means business. And so she finally appeared in the doorway. I was overwhelmed by her beauty, and standing there as a priesthood man, the door opened. She fell into my arms. The reason for that is, how do you resist a priesthood man? Boy, guys, if you could just step it up. Ones that were destroyed in the morning in the Book of Mormon, and ones that were left were first thing the Savior said to him, you got through that, why don't you step up now? Really be somebody. Why don't you go forth in the name of Jesus Christ and make a difference? And so I found out that if you have the Jesus Christ image in your countenance, because his name is written in your heart, you can do stuff. You can go forth in the name of Jesus Christ and accomplish mighty things. And the more you think you can't, I like that talk by Andrew. That was a wonderful talk. He said you're not supposed to be afraid of what could go wrong in the future, but think about what could go right. So it took a lot of courage to marry Susan, and boys, that first day I was inspired of the Lord in the front room to ask her to marry me. And of course, that's a missionary approach to ask people to get baptized, but I then put a clause on it. Quick as you fall in love with me. I knew that wouldn't take long. Because if you're a good person, people fall in love with you. It doesn't matter how you look. If you've got the image of Christ in your face, you look like him. I like the artists all trying to paint what Jesus Christ looks like. He looks like all the good points that you've got and I've got all put together into a countenance that appears on our face. And when you got that, you might not be good looking, but you look good. This pretty well concludes my remarks. I know I believe in God, the Eternal Father, and His Son, Jesus Christ, and in the Holy Ghost. I love this church. I'm going to hang on to it. Boy, how to be walk away from this be about the most unwise thing a person could do. You get married in the name of Jesus Christ, and you raise your children in the name of Jesus Christ. You go off to work in the name of Jesus Christ, and it's all kind of put together in the Church of Jesus Christ. Not perfect people. But it would be if we could be. We're just too dumb to pull it off. When you get to the celestial gates, they'll say, you did all this. All you have to say is that all this was wrong. So I tell them I didn't want it. And tell them, yeah. Anyway, that's the judgment. What do you want? You want to be clever and sarcastic? Or you want to be sweet? You want everybody who meets you to be a little discouraged when they walk away, or a little filled with hope? Jesus Christ did most of the great things he did when he's on his way to do something else. Treat people with love and respect. Susan now is madly in love with me. Not because I'm innocent, but because I try to be good. When I fall up, I'm quick to repent. What a wonderful wife she is, and now you get to hear from her. One of the greatest teachers of this dispensation. She knows more about Joseph Smith any other living person. She knows he's a prophet. She knows he might have had some flaws, but man, what a man. Joseph Smith the prophet. I know he was. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, I view it as a great honor to be able to speak to you. I am very also honored to follow George. What a magnificent husband he has been to me. So women out there, don't settle. You want somebody that looks really good in a blue suit. Because if you're a Latter-day Saint man and you look good in a blue suit, you're going places, right? And you want someone that will love you forever and honor his priesthood. Now, George and I are a lot different in so many different ways. You probably noticed they had to raise the podium with him, right? And you may just as well have noticed they had to lower it for me. I didn't really know if I could marry George Stratton. It was the craziest thing. Imagine there was no first date. There were no flowers. It was a precursor of what I could expect. But nevertheless, I learned something important about it, and perhaps you're taking a note about it. There's a cheaper, easier way than perhaps you're doing it to fall madly in love. But George and I had, in many respects, a lot in common. We both have a testimony that the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is true. We meet some young people that are telling us they're leaving the church because they have questions. And we're saying, well, not us. We're staying because we found so many answers. So with that, I thought I'd share with you my talents. And you'll obviously be able to compare and contrast with George and say, I like George's best, but actually, I like mine. So here goes. You know what else I like about George? He's really glad I got an education. And you know, I would never have met him if I had stopped going to school. Isn't that interesting? So I'm very grateful for that. And what I'd like to talk to you today about is politics. I figure you turn on the TV and it's everywhere, right? And you go, what the heck is going on in our nation? Well, I don't have too many answers for that, but I sure know who I would have voted for in the year 1844. So with that, I now begin. I'm going to share with you about a man that had a lot of courage. Like Andreas said, he just stepped out, wanted to be a difference. We know that Joseph Smith was a great prophet. We know he was a great translator, just the Book of Mormon alone says all of that. But did you know that Joseph Smith, in the year 1844, was a candidate for a U.S. president? Well, we're going to learn a little bit something about that. What was the United States like in 1844? The United States, here was our flag. Notice, if we stopped here long enough, you would be able to count the number of states in the United States at that time, and we had 26. Of our United States, we had, here show the states. They're in blue and kind of a purple. You'll see there's your 26 states. Your farthest western town was a town called Independence, Missouri. And if you look at this, you would say that the United States at that time was divided basically between two political parties. One was the Democratic Party, and the other one was called the Whig. The Whig Party at the time had all the purple states. They could count on those to be able to support their candidate. And the blue states, you see up there, they were going to support a Democratic candidate. What were the issues on the table in the year 1844? There was much talk in the United States in 1844 of something called manifest destiny, which meant that there was much hope that the United States would one day go from sea to shining sea. In fact, they were saying such things as the United States is a little stone cut out without hands that will roll forward and fill the whole earth. They viewed the United States as Nebuchadnezzar's dream and Daniel's then interpretation. On the United States, as they talked about issues, they wanted to go from sea to shining sea, all right, but in 44, what did they want to annex first to the United States? Well, they wanted to annex Texas. What they also wanted to do was they wanted to abolish slavery, or at least it was a topic, because not all states wanted that. There was another issue faced in 1844, and it was Mormonism. Latter-day Saints had been kicked out of the state of Missouri, and Illinois was now wondering what to do with them. Well, in November of 1843, many men, in fact seven, had put their hats in the political arena, saying that they would like to be the next president of the United States. Joseph Smith is very concerned about the seven men. One man is Martin Van Buren, who Joseph had met in the 1840s early and had met with him in Washington, D.C. He had served as our president. And when Joseph indicated the problems that his people had faced in Missouri and wanted a redress for our wrongs, Martin Van Buren had the audacity to say, "Your cause is just, but I will do nothing for you." Another one was John C. Calhoun, you see right here. His hairdo would probably be in vogue today. But nevertheless, John C. Calhoun, as you look at him, he's your state's rights man. He thinks that every state can decide if they want slavery or not. Another man that's thrown his hat in the political arena, in fact, both that you see here, Lewis Cash as well as Richard Johnson, have served as vice presidents. You also get a Henry Clay. He was your famous Speaker of the Senate that could literally stun everyone by his ability to address a large audience. And then, of course, James K. Polk that will ultimately win. The question was, which of these candidates will win in the year 1844? Early pollsters, like we have pollsters today, like the Gallup poll, will go through the 26 states to try and decide which state is a swing state that will be able to name the next president in the year 1844. The conclusion was the state of Illinois. Well, who's the most famous man living in the state of Illinois? It's none other than the prophet Joseph Smith. Joseph Smith at this point claims that he controls 20,000 votes. 20,000 is a majority that will literally tip the way that Illinois will choose, and Joseph now believes that he can actually name who will be the next president of these United States. So he decides that he will write to each of those seven presidential candidates and ask them just one question. The question went like this. If you were elected president of these United States, what would you do in your presidential power to get the people you call Mormons their lands of inheritance back in Jackson County? Well, he wrote the letters to all of them. Not everyone responds. I'm going to assume that there were some issues with the postal system. But of the ones that did respond, I'm going to feature two. One is Henry Clay and John C. Calhoun. Henry Clay, recall, he is your great speaker of the Senate, then of the United States, and John C. Calhoun, he believes that every state has a right to choose, is it slavery or not slavery? They will respond to Joseph Smith's question, but they do it in a very political posturing pose. Each of them, as they respond, they indicate it's such a big issue. I mean, getting your lands back in Jackson County, Missouri. They conclude that when they become the president, they will form some kind of committee, and then they will take it up. In other words, we don't want to make this decision. While we're a candidate, we want your vote. We want the vote of the state of Illinois. Joseph Smith, January 1844. Joseph's frustrated. He literally does not believe that any of the presidential candidates will do anything to help his people. As a result, here shows Joseph Smith's reconstructed red brick store in Nauvoo. There were 38 general stores in Nauvoo. The bottom floor of his store, that's where you shop, and being a shopper, obviously I would have hit all 38 and wondered why there weren't more, right? But on the second floor, that's where you wanted to be. On the top story, that's where Joseph will write the 13 Articles of Faith, all of you that have memorized it. That's where Relief Society will be organized. That's where he will translate then the Book of Abraham. That's where he will write the history of the church. That's where first endowments, first ceilings. And in January 44, Joseph Smith calls his first national political meeting. Attending the meeting would be nobody like us. So women couldn't vote back then. I obviously would be instantly excluded. But Joseph Smith will invite the Quorum of the Twelve, the First Presidency, and the presiding bishop, Newell K. Whitney. So if you're looking far over there, you say, there's Orson Pratt, there's Friday P. Pratt, here's Wilford Woodruff, Orson Hyde, Brigham Young, Joseph's brother William Smith, and the question was, who shall we vote for in 1844? Nobody will do anything for us. Well, there's one man that stood up. He was an apostle. He's kind of junior apostle. He stood up. His name was Willard Richards. And he had concluded, well, I want to vote, but I can't vote for either the Democrat or the Whig because nobody will do anything to get me my lands back in Jackson County. So Willard Richards said, there's only one man I know, if elected president of these United States, would get me my lands of inheritance back in Jackson County. And he said, that man is General Joseph Smith. Now notice, when Joseph runs for president, he doesn't run as, quote, the prophet Joseph Smith, but he runs as General Joseph Smith. So it's always general, advertisements, political, whatever, General Joseph Smith. Now to run for president of these United States, you need to have a vice presidential candidate. Joseph will write to several men in the United States. For example, he writes to the man that's over a large newspaper in New York City named James Arlington Bennett. Says, will you be my vice presidential running mate? He writes back and says, don't associate my name with yours. Are you kidding me? No. No letters were lost in this case. Joseph will also write to a man named Copeland from Tennessee. he will have the same response. Who's willing to run for vice president? Sidney Rigdon. Sidney Rigdon was no longer living in Nauvoo. Sidney had moved to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So notice what the campaign looked like. Notice running for president of these United States in 1844, General Joseph Smith of where? Of Nauvoo, Illinois. His vice presidential candidate, Sidney Rigdon of Pennsylvania, and he was living in Pittsburgh. Well, what would Joseph stand for? You know, if he became president, what would he have done? He actually had a man named William W. Phelps write out for him his views of the government. So the very same man that originated in the Spirit of God like a fire is burning, praise to the man, also wrote Joseph's political platform, with Joseph saying, this is what I want in it. Notice if Joseph were to become president, notice what he would have done in the year 1844. He would have restored the lands lost in Missouri back to the Latter-day Saints. Notice what else he would have done. He would have reduced the pay of Congress. Right away, he'd get my vote. Now, the crazy thing, you'd say, well, how much did he want to reduce the pay of Congress? He wanted to reduce it to $2 a day. And when asked, well, why would you give those men such a small wage? And he said, the difference between a politician and a farmer. He said, a farmer makes about $2 a day. And he goes, well, the difference between a politician and a farmer is a farmer is honest and a politician is not. Ah, he had strong feelings, right? Notice what else Joseph would do. He would greatly expand the United States. In fact, he said if elected one term, he would take the entire hemisphere, meaning the northern hemisphere, into the United States. So when you get other candidates saying, we'll take in Texas, or maybe even James K. Polk was talking Oregon. But notice what Joseph would have taken into the United States. He would have taken Alaska, Canada. He would have taken Mexico, Central America. Do you see that? And when asked, why would you pull all that in? He said, well, after all, it's all Zion, and if elected. Second term, he said, I pull in the whole southern hemisphere. So our great friend over here from Brazil, if Joseph had won, notice, and he said, well, why would you do that? And he said, well, after all, it's Zion too. Joseph would have also eliminated slavery. Now, isn't that interesting? Talked about, you know, there's going to be a war if we don't do something about it. And Joseph had an idea of how to eliminate slavery so we wouldn't have gone through the horrible Civil War. He said, with all that land that's now a part of the United States, he said, those Southerners, they think the slaves are their properties. He said, I would give the Southerners large tracts of land and buy the freedom of the people who have been slaves. And then I would give them a choice. One, you could stay here and be free, or at government's expense, you want to go back to your homelands, even all the way back to Africa. He said, at government expense, we would take ships. So notice he would solve that. He would also solve the monetary program and back our banks with gold or silver. He would reform jails and prisons. At that time, you had 70,000 men in prison for debt. And he said, jails should be institutions of learning. Well, did Joseph have a ghost of a chance to win? I'd say in January, absolutely not. In February of 44, no chance. But then in March of 44, Joseph formed a council called a Council of 50, which no longer exists today. That Council of 50 had a lot of men in it, and one of their leading men was a man down here in the middle named Brigham Young. Well, Brigham Young stood 5'10". He had red hair, freckles, and the temperament that went with that kind of look. He now goes to Joseph Smith and he says, "I've got a plan." He said, "I'd like to be able to call political missionaries to forward your campaign in the 26 states of the United States." And Joseph said, "Well, I can't authorize you to do that, Brigham," but he said, "I tell you what, if there's anybody that'd like to volunteer," he said, you just pass the list by me, and I'll go over it and see if I can spare those men." And then Brigham, "Yeah, you can send them out through the 26 states. Well, Brigham asked for political volunteers. Eventually, you get about 2,000. But the first 350, Joseph looked over the list. And as he looks over the list, he goes, "Okay, Brigham, you can take every one of them but two." He said, "I need two people to stay with me." Notice who he chooses: John Taylor, Willard Richards. John Taylor was a newspaper man in town, and Willard Richards, besides being an apostle, he was Joseph's secretary. Who's with Joseph when he dies? Notice you say, "Where's Brigham?" Well, he's a political volunteer. He's out there in Boston. Well, where's Wilford Woodruff? He's Brigham's companion in Boston. Well, what about his brother William? Well, he's up in Michigan, and Parley P. Pratt is found out through Illinois, Orson Hyde, Orson Pratt. They're in Washington, D.C. Who are the two apostles left behind, not serving political missions when Joseph goes to Carthage? It's these two. These two will then become witnesses that they saw the martyrdom. Well, how was Joseph's campaign from March to June? It was amazing. Conventions, rallies, you're talking Philadelphia, there's 5,000 people. We want General Joseph Smith. You know what he's going to do? He's an expansionist. We've never had a president that's an expansionist like Joseph. He'll change jails. He'll get rid of slavery. There won't be a fight. There won't be conflict. And as these men who are out there would then clip the notices from newspapers, the rallies they would hold in conventions, they would send it to Joseph Smith. Joseph Smith, in the meantime, was living in this house called the Mansion House in Nauvoo. As he was living there, he would receive these letters from the political volunteers. As he received the letters, he started to say, "I can't believe it. I'm becoming popular." Now, he indicates he knows how to be persecuted. You know, he's want to swim in deep waters. But he goes, "I'm popular." And then he goes, "There's enough speaking ability out there." I mean, try and imagine having a Wilford Woodruff on your team if you had run for student body president. I mean, the guy that 36 days after he's in England, he's already baptized 600 people, and two spies sent from the Church of England and a constable that came to arrest him, he's baptized him. I mean, you know, if he were out there campaigning for you, well, let alone a Brigham Young or a Orson Hyde, that, well, pretty soon Joseph is saying, "I am afraid that I'm going to win on the first electoral ballot." So the first electoral ballot, he's worried about that because of the political volunteers. Well, as Joseph would receive these letters, he would then hand them to John Taylor, and John Taylor would print them in this newspaper called the Nauvoo Neighbor. Well, you can imagine, well, you'd say, "Well, then, is Joseph out campaigning?" And I go, "Nope, never leaves Nauvoo. He doesn't have to. Look who's on his team." Well, there was one man in Nauvoo, and we should probably all hiss and boo, but his name was William Law. He didn't like it. He didn't like the idea that Joseph might become the next president. He forms a group called the Conspirators. The Conspirators eventually publish a newspaper of their own called the Nauvoo Expositor. Let us expose Joseph Smith to the world, the man they believe they know. Let us expose Mormonism. What's the impact of one man? The impact of one man for ill will ultimately lead to what we know as Carthage Jail and will lead to the martyrdom. Joseph Smith was then shot and killed while running for president of these United States. Who's your next presidential candidate to be shot and killed while running for president of the United States? Well, it was John F. Kennedy's brother, Robert. So in my lifetime was the next, not in most of yours, but there was the next. Well, how did the election turn out in 1844? You know, it was really close popular vote. The second circle you can see here, popular vote, only divided by about 2 million. And you're very, very, very close. Electoral vote, however, will go to the Democrats. Who wins in that case? This man, James K. Polk. As James K. Polk becomes president, his issue was manifest destiny. He declares war with Mexico. The United States goes to war. As it goes to war, Latter-day Saints become involved as we organize into what's called a Mormon battalion. Well, I'd like to close, and I'd like to invite Big George to come up and stand next to me. Well, I love this man. You know, when he showed up at my doorstep and the first time I was seeing him, we'd first met 38 years before, and I hadn't had many occasions to bump into him. And the first time he came to see me, he asked me to marry him. I called one of my sons, and he came rushing over with a can of mace. And, you know, he said, "Hey, Mom, you don't have to go through this." I called another son, and he goes, "You know, Mom, do you really think a better man will ever knock on your door?" And I go, "Well, that's not the point." But, you know, it actually took me a year to fall in love with George. And we're in southern Utah, and we're up at a place called Kola. I don't know if you've been there. It's beautiful, one of our beautiful mountain ranges. And we hiked up about as far as old Duffers can hike, which means we opened the door and stepped out to the edge. And George said, "Well, here's the ring." And he said, "If you look close, it's a diamond." And I go, "Maybe I just don't have it in the right light, George. I'm just not seeing this." And he goes, now you squint. You're going to see this." And he goes, "Marry me or I'm going to jump." I didn't know, you know, as a widow, I couldn't really seem to find this permanent happiness. But George is fun. We have many occasions to laugh every day, and that's fun. He's not high maintenance.
That's also great.
And you'll never find him shopping in Nordstrom, so, you know, without him, vice versa. But we've learned to work it out and to be very happy. He says, "If you want to see a woman in love, look at me." And so I think he's probably right. Now, if you were to say about the two of us, you'd say, "Boy, your styles are dramatically different." And what a blessing that is. We have a message for you. The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is true. I've studied Joseph Smith's life backwards and forwards. And, you know, I can't find anything that has thrown me off. In other words, he was a prophet. He was trying to make a difference in this world. He even ran for president of the United States. George is trying to share with you that if you're a priesthood man, you know your dreams can come true. And so with that, I'm going to have George give our testimony, shall you? We're so honored you come. You must not have known you're speaking. But thank you. So I want you to hear his testimony again, because ladies, this is what you want.
I'd like y'all to try to go to the celestial kingdom because I want to see you again. The most surprising thing you'll see in the celestial kingdom is the surprised look on other people's faces. I found out that as I was a dud in high school that I didn't have much confidence, but self-confidence, and I learned later that you don't have to have self-confidence, you just have to have Christ confidence. In His name, all things will work together for your good. I pray that you'll find somebody. I know it's not easy sometimes to find a priesthood man. That's why all us priesthood men are better. Be good ones. There's not enough to go around, really. But bless your hearts and just take it one step at a time. And if your dreams are not coming true yet, like Susan said, they will. And we love you. We love each other, and life is good. Just go out into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God. That's what King George said during the Second World War. That's better than a light, but safer than a known light. Stay close to religion. Religion's fun. It's not sour and hard. It's soft and gentle and sweet. And the only way you can achieve it is in the name of Jesus Christ and with the holy influence of the Holy Ghost. And I love Susan. I think I keep her forever. Wish we could go on and on, but if we don't get out of here, we'll be in trouble. President Richards. What a man he is, his wife. How would it be to grow up to be like them? Don't settle for anything less. Love you, Susan. Thanks for letting me come back and speak with you. I was kind of a dead, you know. I was sitting in my chair at home watching Dancing with the Stars. Susan then took me and resurrected me. And, amen. Do you want to say
anything? No, you're much loved. We say this in Jesus' name. Amen.